From a $10 billion artificial island to Singapore's new megaport and new high-speed rail lines, in this video, we've compiled six of the most impressive transportation megaprojects planned for 2030. Be sure to watch until the end, because I've got a bonus project in store for you to finish off on a high note. The country of Portugal's had a high-speed rail system since the 1990s. However, the speed limit is 220 kilometers an hour, and they're looking to upgrade and expand the existing system by 2030. The primary expansion currently underway is the construction of the Lisbon-Porto line. Currently, the traditional train journey between the 314 kilometers separating Portugal's two biggest cities takes nearly 4 hours. The new high-speed line aims to cut that travel time down to a fraction of its former self, carrying passengers from Porto to Lisbon at 300 kilometers an hour, for a journey time of just over an hour. But it won't happen overnight. The new line is planned in three phases. The first section between Sauer and Porto is scheduled for completion in 2027, saving 50 minutes on the current journey. And the second phase between Sauer and Carregado is scheduled for completion in 2030, reducing the final journey time to 1 hour and 17 minutes. A step forward that comes at a cost. The project's expected to cost just shy of 5 billion euros, a billion of which will be provided by the European Union. The double-track line will also be built to very particular specifications, conforming to the Iberian gauge. This is the second widest distance between rails of any railway in the world. This is significant because it'll limit the potential interconnectivity of the rail line. Despite the exhilarating prospect of 300 km/h speeds, Portugal is reportedly not united in excitement over the project. In southern cities such as Faro, which are less populous but see heavy tourism, there are some who feel the rail plans leave them out of the equation. However, even if it is somewhat divisive between the north and south of the country, this ambitious project should have a beneficial impact on the economy of both cities and, more broadly, on Portugal's tourism sector. With 87 million passengers in 2023, Dubai is already the world's second busiest airport. First place goes to Atlanta, Georgia, which welcomed 104 million passengers in the same year. But by 2034, the United Arab Emirates could well be in first place. In fact, that year, Dubai Airports Company projected to complete a new airport. Located just over 20 miles south of Dubai, Al Maktoum International Airport is currently undergoing perhaps the most significant expansion of any airport in the world today. Estimated cost? Over $35 billion. When finished, it'll feature gates for 400 aircraft and the capacity for a whopping 260 million passengers per year. Dubai will eventually close its main airport, Dubai International, and transfer all traffic to Al Maktoum. Inaugurated in 2010, the aim of this second airport was to rapidly establish itself in freight transport while offering a second gateway for travelers visiting the emirate. But while it has succeeded in its freight business, passenger traffic has never really taken off. But this situation is set to change radically in 2034, when the first phase of the project is due to be completed. Indeed, Al Maktoum Airport will rank as the world's largest airport, if, of course, no competing projects see the light of day between now and then. In April 2024, sketches of the new terminal were unveiled. The site will include numerous green spaces and 100,000 square meters of commercial space. The new facilities will cover almost 70 square kilometers, and the airport will be connected to the center of the emirate by an express highway and a railroad line. Al Maktoum International Airport will be the central part of a larger megaproject called Dubai South. This massive endeavor has been underway since 2006 and aims to build an entire city adjacent to Dubai. In addition to its brand new airport, the city will be home to up to 1 million people, roughly a third of Dubai's current population. The project makes one thing clear: Dubai expects to continue being one of the world's most visited places in the next decade. Portugal's not the only country gearing up to finish a high-speed rail line by 2030. Another country racing against the clock is Thailand. Unlike Portugal, Thailand does not currently have any high-speed rail lines. However, there have been talks to develop a comprehensive network since 2010, where trains will be able to travel at up to 250 kilometers per hour. As of 2022, the country had mapped out routes covering the country almost from top to bottom, with Bangkok serving as the central hub. For the Southeast Asian nation of over 70 million, it's an image of transportation completely revolutionized. But to turn this map into reality, Thailand has had to embark on an expensive, complicated, and long journey. Of the four proposed lines, only one is currently under construction, the one linking Bangkok to Nakhon Ratchasima in the northeast by 2028, then connecting Nakhon Ratchasima to Nong Khai by 2030. Even these dates are relatively new. As recently as 2019, news outlets were reporting the first leg of the rail line would be carrying passengers in 2023. Soon, that date became 2026, and now, at the time of this video, it's 2028. There's reasons for the delay. One is China. China seeks to link itself with Thailand and Laos as part of its Belt and Road Initiative, and has agreed to help finance the construction of high-speed rail in Thailand. Thailand's expected to need more than $10 billion for this first line alone. But negotiations have reportedly been contentious and slow when it comes to loan terms and interest rates. Despite this, Thailand is continuing to make progress. In April 2024, the State Railway of Thailand gave the official green light for Phase 2 of construction. With the help of another $10 billion, Phase 2 means the construction of a 357-kilometer line from Nakhon Ratchasima to Nong Khai. It remains to be seen whether the finances will be sufficient to complete the entire line. Now we're heading a little further south, to Malaysia, where a huge artificial island is to be built, the Melaka Gateway. Initially launched all the way back in 2014, Melaka Gateway is about as large-scale a megaproject as one can imagine. Off the coast of Malacca, a Malaysian company called KAJ Development is building an artificial island. The island will become the site of a major tourism and commercial hub for the region. Even this, however, is a significantly scaled-back version of what Malaysia initially wanted to create. Back in 2014, the plan was to build three artificial islands, all centered around a fourth natural island. Estimated at $10 billion, this vast program included the construction of residential and commercial areas, leisure infrastructures, and even a port and industrial zone. Overall, the artificial archipelago would have created 45,000 new jobs, but a slew of obstacles has forced Malaysia to scale back the project. Of all the obstacles, perhaps the most striking has been the political opposition Melaka Gateway's faced. The project's biggest opponent has been none other than the Prime Minister of Malaysia himself, Mahathir Mohamad. Mohamad held office between 2018 and 2020 and was firmly against Melaka Gateway for several reasons. He was concerned about China's heavy investment in the project and China's growing influence in Malaysia. He was also concerned about the potential environmental impact, and he even voiced skepticism about the project's viability, full stop. The Melaka Gateway project went as far as being temporarily cancelled in 2020. But in 2022, after a new prime minister, Anwar Ibrahim, took office, the project's been brought back to life, albeit in a scaled-down form. The central focus now is on the construction of the Melaka International Cruise Terminal. The investment cost is $156 million. The new terminal is scheduled to open to the public in 2026. A large marina, a high-end hotel complex, and commercial areas are also planned. According to the promoters, the Melaka Gateway could attract up to 3.5 million tourists a year in the long term, a significant economic asset for the entire region. Although the feasibility of the project as a whole is still in doubt, the scaled-down version is receiving a great deal of support. In addition to federal approval, the Sultan of Johor, Malaysia's current king, has become directly involved in the project. In March 2023, he was even its second-largest shareholder. This strong backing suggests that this first artificial island has a great chance of seeing the light of day. Following the construction of a gigantic fifth terminal at Changi Airport, Singapore's embarking on another pharaonic project, the Tuas Megaport. The country's already inaugurated the first three berths of this new port in September 2022. Currently, 11 berths are operational, However, much remains to be done before it can officially replace Singapore's current port. Scheduled to be 100% operational by 2040, the Port of Tuas will become the world's largest and most technologically advanced commercial port. Estimated cost, $20 billion. A total of 66 quays along a 26-kilometer stretch will handle up to 65 million containers a year. By way of comparison, this is 1.5 times what Shanghai, the world's largest port, currently does. The city-state of Singapore, world-renowned for its quality of life and ultra-modern infrastructure, is already home to the world's second-largest port. So why embark on such a construction project? Well, for the simple reason that the shipping sector represents a considerable part of Singapore's economy. This is due in no small part to its strategic position on shipping routes as the gateway to the Strait of Malacca. Today, 7% of Singapore's GDP comes from the maritime sector, a flourishing sector that supports 170,000 workers and 5,000 companies across the state. But with global trade booming, competition is intensifying. Neighboring countries such as Malaysia and Thailand would also like to benefit from this boom and are already building alternatives to the route through the Singapore Strait. By the way, if you're interested in this subject, you'll find a description of my video dedicated to the new Malaysian and Thai corridor. In 2021, the Port of Singapore handled 37 million standard ship containers, ranging from 20 to 40 feet in length. But Tan Chong Meng, who is CEO of PSA International, the port operator in charge of the project, says this isn't even close to enough to keep up with the demands of the near future. The Malacca Strait, which runs between Sumatra and Malaysia and sees around 40% of all traded goods globally, will see demand for over 100 million standard ship containers by 2040. To remain an international maritime leader, Singapore's new Tuas port will double the Port of Singapore's current capacity, and it'll do it by being fully automated. Over 1,000 battery-powered four-wheel driverless vehicles will move cargo containers in the terminal. Overhead, the largest fleet of self-operating cranes in the world will, quite literally, pick things up from there. Tuas is expected to have nearly 1,000 automated cranes. And things need to move fast, as PSA, the port operator, plans to transfer all its operations from the Tanjong Pagar, Keppel and Brani terminals to the Port of Tuas by 2027. Eventually, the current Port of Singapore will even be closed. By that year, the new port should have 21 deep water berths, capable of handling 20 million containers a year. However, the new port will not be fully operational until 2040. However, one question remains unanswered. What will happen to the current port's employees if the Tuas port is 100% automated? On this subject, experts are rather pessimistic. In any case, one thing is certain. If the city-state succeeds in its gamble, the Tuas megaport could bring it much-coveted prosperity for decades to come. Now, let's head a little further west, to a country not particularly known for its megaprojects, Sri Lanka. Located at the southern tip of India, this island nation is currently building a port city on a huge artificial island, Colombo Port City. The aim is clear: to create a special economic zone with advantageous taxation to attract foreign companies and investors. By 2030, Colombo Port City is to become a new hub for South Asia, focusing on the tech, finance, and maritime trade sectors. To achieve this, 5 districts are planned, with a business center, luxury residential areas, and amenities such as a park and marina. Emerging to the west of the capital, Colombo, the island has been under construction since 2014. Project cost? Nearly $15 billion. And construction's progressing well. In January 2019, the platform construction phase was completed. In total, nearly 269 hectares of artificial land have been reclaimed from the sea, a colossal operation carried out by a Chinese company. With its 5.6 million inhabitants, Colombo's already the epicenter of Sri Lankan commerce. But there's no doubt that this new port city will give a real boost to the economy of the entire region, a considerable asset for the country, which has been experiencing a serious slowdown in growth since 2022. The poverty rate's risen considerably over the last 5 years, from 11.3% in 2019 to 25.9% in 2023. And this rate's set to remain above 22% until 2026, according to the World Bank. Port City Colombo is therefore a huge gamble for Sri Lanka. It'll cost a lot of money, but if it succeeds, it could truly change the country's economic landscape. It remains to be seen what will really happen in 2030. While some countries race to carve out space for planes to land and railways for trains to move, others aim to build close to the clouds. Among them is China. In 2030, Puxian Shanghai is expected to have a new tallest building, a breathtaking 99-story skyscraper called North Bund Center. Construction, which begins in March 2023, is in good hands, as it's being overseen by New York architecture firm Cone Peterson Fox, which has already built some of the world's most iconic skyscrapers. To name just a few, there's the Hong Kong International Commerce Center, the Lotte World Tower in Seoul, South Korea, and another just across the street from his new creation, the Shanghai World Financial Center, more commonly known as the Bottle Opener. With its striking design, inspired by the white magnolia, the official flower of the city of Shanghai, the North Bund Center will embody the new face of Puxi, just as the Shanghai Tower did in Pudong. The building seen by the North Bund Development Office as a central piece in the larger surge of development expected in the area by 2030. That date marks the anticipated time frame for 300,000 new jobs spread throughout 100 multinational headquarters to appear on the scenic waterfront of Puxi. Standing 480 meters high, the North Bund Center will also become the tallest building in Puxi. In fact, in Shanghai, a city that's home to some of the tallest buildings ever constructed, it'll be the third tallest, following only Shanghai Tower and the iconic Shanghai World Financial Center. But this new tower won't just reach for the clouds. To support China's vision of becoming fully carbon neutral by 2060, the tower is fully electrified. It'll even be the world's tallest all-electric skyscraper, consuming no fossil fuels, claims the American architectural firm. And that's not all. By catching the sun at an oblique angle, the facade minimizes solar heat gain, while integrated photovoltaic solar panels harvest electricity. A final point of note in terms of eco-design, the tower's flared base collects rainwater and directs it to holding cisterns, aiding with urban flood mitigation and providing irrigation for a park at ground level. On the face of it, the project has all the makings of a successful new landmark for the city of Shanghai. And with this little bonus, we end the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you'd like to discover other impressive transport megaprojects, check out my videos on the new corridors in Iraq and Thailand. See you soon on Looking 4.